Yeah, morning.
Hey, morning. Okay. Checking out of room 22.
Lovely. Nothing to buy, all done?
Yeah, all
done. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Good morning, coffee drinkers. Time to say goodbye to Tracy Park and head up to Stratford-upon-Avon and go and visit Chelsea's friend William. William H. Macy? No, William H. something. William Milkshake? William Pear Shake, Shakespeare. That's right. What is it? The Englishness continues. Right, we're in historical Stratford-upon-Avon. And my question is, it appears to me that Shakespeare is much bigger business 400 years later than he probably ever was at the time. I mean, based on sheer population change and the amount of tourists we've seen since we've been here for, I don't know, 4.5 minutes. Swans are pretty friendly here, although they are capable of like breaking your arm with their wings. They're so strong. And all owned by the Queen.
What?
The Queen owns all the swans, all the dolphins, and all the whales in British territorial waters. It's
if
crazy,
I was the Queen,
huh?
Honestly, I would also make that rule.
Yeah, that fun fact brought to you by the fact that I just watched The Queen at 90 on Netflix for some unknown reason. It's actually quite funny. And I did learn a few things. But this is beautiful Stratford-upon-Avon. It's actually really cool. It's good taking a little downtime the next few days, seeing some of my country again without having to work and being able to show it to Chelsea. That's pretty cool. Now, we're gonna do fish and chips, like for real, for real.
Hi there, cod and chips twice, please.
Thank you.
First English chip. I gotta have the reaction on camera. Yeah, it's a little bit different here. We know how to do chips in England. Not something to be that proud of, unfortunately, but we definitely know how to do chips. Time to make a drive to the Peak District. Jet lag is still in effect. Time for some reload, or liquid Play-Doh as Bob calls it, but I still don't get that.
What?
Mmm. It's tasty.
Chelsea doesn't think so.
Did you want
it? All right, we made it to Macclesfield. I really can't talk that much because Chelsea needs to cough so badly. So maybe we'll just point the camera in front. And she can cough her brains out. All right, so this is Mam Tour. At least the start of it. And they near the summit together. The wind around them rises. And they break new ground never before trodden by mankind. Despite the fact there's a perfectly beautifully laid path.
The sheep built that.
The sheep did indeed build that. Looks like they had lunch there, dinner there. Yes, here at Coffee with Janek Incorporated, our goal is to bring you variation in the vlog, I think. Because the blue couch and the plane over changes can get a little monotonous at times. So we do crazy things like fly to the north of England and stand on the top of a mountain for your watching enjoyment. And we really should have worn long pants, my bad. Sorry.
Here it is.
Yeah? Is it worth the trip?
Oh, yeah.
I think this is a view worth hiking a little for?
A little bit, yeah.
We'll be right back. already got really windy up here. We're starting to get cold. Let's make the descent. Say goodbye.
One more.
We are live streaming here from England, and I am almost done editing today's vlog. It's getting to be towards midnight here. I thought we would get online here and take a few live vlog questions. Chelsea's here.
Hi.
The million-dollar question from Wolf Danvers. How's your chord book going?
That's my question too, Wolf.
Well, to answer that million-dollar question, why don't you speak to my copyist here?
Hello. Your phone's about to die. That's not smart.
No. You want to grab the cord for me?
Sure.
While I'm holding the computer.
Question.
Yeah, sorry. Thank you, darling. Mm-hmm. We've got the power supply for the phone, so it won't die now. Daryl Anders. Hey, Daryl. Of course, what? Do me a massive favor and grab a packet of strings out of the bag. They're in there somewhere. Just dig around. We're about to display. Daryl asks, what are your favorite strings? What luck. I just happen to have a set right here. Check those bad boys out. Dunlop Super Brights. Come on, people. You know I play those strings. But yeah, there you go. Chelsea's working at the same time as helping me answer questions here. She's the multi-type. Women are great at that. I suck at that. Women are awesome at that. I just sit here in awe. Calabrese JF asks, what's your take on negative harmony? I'm seeing this more and more. Well, I guess what you're seeing is a couple of Jacob Collier interviews where he talks about negative harmony. What's my take? I don't have a take on it, really. I use it like just the same as he does, and like pretty much everyone does, because it's the same 12 notes that we all deal with, right? In Western music, you know, unless you get into microtonal stuff, it's the same 12 notes, I think, that we all deal with. And look, here it is. I think my take on harmony in general is that I have an understanding of it. It's definitely not the greatest understanding on earth. It's definitely not rudimentary. It's somewhere in the middle. It's a good understanding, let's say that. And based upon that, I try and make emotional rather than theoretical choices. That's my take on it. What's your take on it?
I agree with you. I think he's...
Don't say that just because
it's
me.
I mean, no, I do. I think he's giving a new name to something that's been done.
But there's been an existence for, yeah.
Right, and he's calling it negative harmony and everyone's freaking out thinking it's like dark matter or something, but it's really just...
Although he's not the one calling it negative harmony, he's just referring to that book, right? That
no,
called it negative
right,
harmony.
But because
he's just the one bringing it up,
yeah,
right?
And he said the thing, everyone's freaking out.
Right, because he has kind of a voice right now because he's the hot thing and so everyone's freaking out about it. But, and he can also like make vocal examples of it, like really in tune and... really out of tune if he wants to, which is pretty sick.
That's
like
pretty cool, yeah.
And by out of tune, I mean he can really sing purposely out of tune, which right. is just ridiculous. But again, it's, you know, I see that and I feel it's more, and I don't know how maybe he's just explaining it very eloquently and he's making the same choices that I feel I'm making in terms of them being emotional. I don't know. I would have to ask him that. That would be a great question for someone to ask Jacob Collier in an interview. Are you making theoretical or emotional choices when you play music? You know what I mean? Right?
Totes.
I'd like to hear about that. I'd like to not hear about any more theory ever again, basically. That's where I'm at with it. But that's just me. And I would love to hear, like, an honest answer. Like, is he making theoretical choices or is he making emotional choices? That would be very interesting to hear. I'm sure that would be an awesome discussion. And I'm sure it would be a great answer, no matter what it was. And obviously, his music is great. And, you know, at the end of the day, it probably doesn't matter. You're either a fan of his music or you're not. Or of anyone's music, I think. So, great question. Harry Plays Drums asks, biggest advice for someone trying to make a living from music? We are both going to answer this. Ready your answer.
I'm already ready.
You're ready? Okay, so you go first. That's perfect. You go first.
All right. Well, my answer for myself is don't just be good at one thing, especially living in Los Angeles. You have to do everything. And the second you decide that you're not going to do that, you just deleted like 500 gigs for yourself. So if you just tell yourself, you take the, as my dad says, you take the gig first and then learn whatever it is that you took the gig for after. Don't say, oh shoot, I can't do that, but maybe I could do the gig. No, just take the gig and figure it out. That's my advice.
And that's very much, I heard Steve Jobs talk about that a lot. Ex-CEO of Apple. He talked about that. Take the gig and learn on the gig. I think that's amazing advice. What would I add to that? I think the more you can be honest with yourself about what you truly want to do and love to do, the better. That is not always a wise financial choice. I have to say that. Really, it isn't. You know, I went through some super duper rough times and lean times, shall we say, in terms of nutrition, because I didn't want to play wedding gigs and I didn't want to play corporate gigs. And I really made a conscious decision not to do that. My entire career, I think I've played 2 wedding gigs. That's it. And a handful of corporate... What?
This guy.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm just... That's just my take on it. You had your take?
Mm-hmm.
Which I
100%... No, I'm just saying I'm jealous that you've never played wedding gigs. That's all.
Yeah, but you're also not jealous of the fact that you probably ate Marmite on toast for like days on end.
Wait, what on toast?
Exactly. You don't want to know. We're in England right now, and okay. even then, you don't want to know. So that's our take on it. I hope that helps. Janek, you are so fat. Well, that's a new one.
I think he means with a PH. Right?
Well, he wrote it with an F, but
yeah.
I don't know, dude. Inigo. Okay, I can't really pronounce that name, but the question is, Janek, can you recommend an awesome compressor pedal?
It's Inigo Mantecón.
Okay. Okay, so the Cubana in the room can pronounce that name, so thank you. Yeah, I can recommend the compressor pedal that I use, which is super awesome. It's by Miura Guitars, and it's the, what's it called, the M2?
Wow.
I don't actually know, but it's really easy because it's the only compressor pedal they make. Miura Guitars, M-I-U-R-A Guitars, Miura Guitars. It's in my pedal board. All the time now. I haven't stopped using it since I got it. I haven't stopped using that compression pedal. It is super warm. It's really, huh?
It's beautiful.
It really is beautiful. I mean, I played it to Chelsea. I wish I had the reaction on your face, like the, when it was off and I played, and then I switched it, and it was like, you know, the light shone down. It's really warm. It does make a difference. I never used compression before that. Not in a clean sense. I would use it in a messed up pedal chain sense. But before that, I would never use compression in my regular everyday sound. And before that, I used an old CS2, the compression sustainer pedal, the blue one by Boss, the vintage one. And, but now, yeah, the Miura. I think it's the M2. I should really check that. Sergey Shinebase asks, what preamp do I use? Well, my main preamp that I use in recordings, I used on the entire last tour, is the Noble preamp and DI, which is unbelievable. It's tubes, it's warm, it's huge. Between the Noble Pre and the Miura compressor, that's an unbelievably fun sound to have and great sound. You read the question.
Will you guys ever do a bass duet?
We're both just looking at each other and not saying anything right now. So who knows? That's an ambiguous answer from both of us.
I think it'd be pretty impressive if we went our entire relationship and never did it.
Okay, by entire relationship, I mean, I'm sort of hoping that's sort of long term.
Let's say.
Forever?
Yeah. That would be a little ridiculous. So let's
okay, for if we stay together forever until the very end, which I very much hope we do. Was that a no? Oh, okay, that was a cute thing. Ah, okay, sorry, my ears are not great. I'm a bass player, let's face it. It's a good question. Chelsea, this one's for you. Well, it's for both of us, but this one's for you first. Do you think that jazz music can be learned just by ear and listening?
This is your question.
No, because I have my answer already. I want a contrast here.
Okay, here's what Yannick's going to say.
No!
He's going to say there were millions of musicians. I mean, think of all the blind guys who never could read music. They had no choice, right? They have no choice. So there you go. That's the answer.
No, but that's what you said. That's what I'm going to say.
Yeah.
Okay, it's true. What are you going to say?
I think that, of course, it can be done, but if you want to really help yourself out, I would say maybe go some other paths. That's all.
You're just going to leave it go some other paths. No direction, no advice, no guidance. I mean.
Okay. Are we going to go through this?
We're going there.
Okay. I think you should learn your modes. And actually, you don't even really need to read music to do that. So there you go. Just know your scales.
Look,
you're good to go.
I don't disagree with you with knowing modes and knowing scales. I think you have to know the fingerboard. I think you have to know your instrument. I think you have to know where all the notes are.
Absolutely.
On it. I am just of the opinion that knowing modes and scales isn't the only way.
And I completely
to
agree.
Do that.
I don't think
okay?
those things are mutually exclusive.
And I think that people are wired differently. You know, and some people learn. Everyone learns completely differently. I think. And I think that some people are wired better for doing it you know, from somewhat of a theoretical standpoint, and others are not. Others learn completely by ear, and I think I perhaps am a mixture of that. Maybe you are as well, mm-hmm. ear and theory. But definitely my goal is to get away from the theory as fast as possible. You know, if you think about modes and scales, learn them and forget about them. And when we say learn them, we like mean really learn them. So you don't have to ever think about them again. It's one thing to learn something and then continually have to think about it. It's something quite different to really learn something and never have to make a conscious, never have to have a conscious thought process to bring that information back ever again. So there are definitely different scales of whether you've learned something or not. And I think a lot of people don't get to that point where it's completely in their muscle memory. I think the faster you can get to that point, if you're going the theoretical route, the better, because then you can quit harmony, basically, or at least a thought process of harmony, and make emotional choices rather than theoretical ones. God, did we just agree on something, kind of?
I always tell you we agree, and you always say we don't.
Okay. Cloudburn asks,
how long will you continue to vlog on YouTube?
It's a good question. It's one she really wants me to answer, and she wants the number to be really low.
No, the
truth is, I set myself the goal of doing 365 consecutive days, 1 year of vlogging. So far, so good. What are we, 203 today? Hmm. We're heading towards being two-thirds of the way through the project, and then it will sit on YouTube as like a body of work, 365 videos. And I don't know, I love it. You know, like, there are some days where it's tougher than others, I gotta say. And there are some days where I'm like, oh my God, like, I've just done 8 million things and now there's a vlog to do. Mm-hmm. And some days, you know, when I hit the upload button, when I hit the publish button, am I as happy as some other days? No. Like, is the product as good, as great as it could be every single time? No. But the consistency is an amazing teacher for me in terms of discipline and work ethic. And that's something I like to keep really, really sharp. So I'll forfeit some, you know, a couple of bad days here and there in terms of the production and the content. And it's never bad. Like, it's never like, oh my God, I could never have this scene in public. But there are times when I'm like, oh crap, I could have done that a little better. Or I had another thought that was going somewhere else. But for the most part, it's just an honest representation of what's happening every day in life, I think. And that's important for me right now. It probably will always be important. I probably just won't be able to do it as frequently. If I can hit this 365-day goal, I won't be able to do it as frequently as perhaps I have been so far. Jacob Grin, check this question out. What is the best thing to study to become a session musician?
Reading.
Pro Tools. She went with reading. Because there's still hope there.
Oh.
There's still optimism there.
No.
I love it. There's still optimism that there is a session scene left. There isn't. There is not. I'll tell you who there's a session scene left for. I'll tell you. And I'll be totally honest. And I'd be really surprised if you don't agree with me. But tell me if you don't.
All right.
There is a session scene for he or she who is patient enough to stay in one place, to never go on the road, and to commit their life 100% to only playing in the studio, regardless of anything else. Agree or disagree?
Disagree.
Disagree. Disagree why?
Because there are plenty of people who still go on the road and do tons of other gigs, but they get in with the people who already have the jobs, and then when those people decide they don't want the jobs anymore, they call the people they like the best.
Okay, so you're talking about a replacement sub on a generic union session.
Sure.
Okay. I'm talking about being a session musician as a career to the point that you can sustain that.
No, but that's what I'm talking about.
To where people will actually call you for what you do rather than you sound like Wayne Bergeron or something
you can replace him
at any time.
But you have to get there eventually, and when Wayne gets old enough to want to retire, he's going to call someone consistently who he thinks is the next him, who's the next Wayne Bergeron, and that's how you get your next career.
Okay.
Because Wayne is nowhere near given out yet.
Oh, no, of course not. A lot of those. Chuck Finley's still doing it, and he's got 20 years on Wayne, probably. So we both totally disagree on that one. Wow, I didn't see that one coming, but there you go. Not that I could put it all in the vlog, but the Instagram Q&A went an hour. I didn't even realize there was a time limit on Instagram, and they shut us down after an hour of answering questions. Awesome. Thank you, guys. It was a great way to bolster the content of today's vlog. But, oh, my God. That one's gonna smell. Oh. Oh, you might want to breathe through your mouth for a while. Oh, man. Yeah, she's bailing. She's bailing. Man overboard. Woo! All right, but on that bombshell, today's vlog is done. We'll see you guys tomorrow.